Good morning and welcome to the 27th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our main item of business this morning is the consideration of a statutory instrument, the Social Security Miscellaneous Amendment and Transitional Provision, Scotland Regulations 2022 draft. The Scottish Government advises these regulations make changes to the Best Start Foods Regulations, Best Start Grant Regulations and Scottish Child Payment Regulations that set out the rules and eligibility criteria for Best Start Foods, Best Start Grant and Scottish Child Payment. I welcome Ben McPherson, MSP, Minister for Social Security and Local Government, who is joining us remotely today, and I also welcome his officials who are also joining us remotely. We've got Nicola Birrell, who's Best Start Grant and Best Start Foods Policy Manager from the Scottish Government, Karen Clyde, who's Solicitor for the Scottish Government, Janet Richardson, Deputy Director, Client Services Delivery, Social Security Scotland, and Marilyn Kemp, who's the Scottish Child Payment Team Leader at the Scottish Government. This instrument is laid under the affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before it comes into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited at the next agenda item to consider a motion to approve the instrument. I remind everyone that the Scottish Government officials can speak under this item, but not in the debate that follows. And I'll now invite the Minister to make a short opening statement. Minister.
Thank you, Convener. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can. Yep.
Thank you. And sorry I can't be with you all in person this morning due to coronavirus, and thank you for your understanding in that. And thank you for the opportunity to discuss with you this morning the Social Security Miscellaneous Amendment and Transition Provision Scotland Regulations 2022. These regulations make changes to the Best Start Foods Regulations, Best Start Grant Regulations and Scottish Child Payment Regulations. They also correct an administrative oversight identified in the Ukraine regulations, and this is required to ensure parity of access to benefits on arrival in Scotland and the rest of the UK, specific to people who hold Irish citizenship. Scottish Child Payment, Best Start Foods and the three Best Start Grant payments, that's pregnancy and baby payment, early learning payment and school age payment, colleagues will know, are known collectively as the five family payments, and delivered by Social Security Scotland, they are five different payments which aim to provide support to low-income families with the costs of raising a child. And all five payments are intended to help tackle inequality, improve outcomes, and make a positive impact on all of the priority groups identified in the Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan. These regulations before us today support the focus this Scottish Government has placed on tackling and reducing child poverty, as has the Parliament more widely. The main changes we are making are to extend eligibility for the Scottish Child Payment to low-income families with children aged 6 to 15. Secondly, the regulations are intended to increase the value of the Scottish Child Payment to £25 per child per week, and also to allow Social Security Scotland to automatically pay Best Start Grant Early Years Payment and Best Start Grant School Age Payment to eligible people who are in receipt of Scottish Child Payment. These regulations before us today also widen the definition of kinship care across Best Start Grant, Best Start Foods and Scottish Child Payment to ensure that the regulations include all kinship carers with a relevant legal order or agreement with the local authority. And this will ensure that kinship carers are included who are not related to the child but are known to them and have a pre-existing relationship with the child. And this change will also help ensure better consistency across the payments, something I know the Scottish Commission on Social Security welcome. Draft regulations were referred to the Scottish Commission on Social Security in March, and we received their scrutiny report in June, and the Scottish Government response to their recommendations was laid in Parliament on the 20th of September. As always, I am extremely grateful to the Scottish Commission on Social Security for its scrutiny and recommendations. And finally, I would also wish to remind members that we laid regulations yesterday to introduce further ancillary provisions to ensure that the regulations we are discussing today deliver on the policy intent effectively. And I welcome this opportunity to speak with you all as colleagues on the committee and your considerations of these regulations, and I look forward to any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your statement, Minister. We're now going to move on to questions from members. And as always, we'll direct our questions to yourself, and you can bring your officials in when you want to. I'm going to turn to questions first from my colleague, Jeremy Balfour. Jeremy, over to yourself.
Good morning, Minister, and good morning to your team. Thank you for coming along. I wonder, can the Minister detail a process for families who have a child who will be turning six before these regulations extend the age limit come into force, i.e. a family could have a Scottish Child Payment award stopped for a child whose sixth birthday is October 2022 and have to reapply in November, which is obviously difficult for the family and also administratively could cause issues. Has that been looked at, and what is the solution?
Considered. First of all, there are approximately 6,000 children that will have aged out, to use the phrase, in the 12 weeks prior to the launch date on the 14th of November. Approximately 3,000 children from this cohort will have their Scottish Child Payment claim ended at this point, with the other 3,000 children and being from households who also have a younger child who are still in receipt of Scottish Child Payment. And so we will be sending, as in Social Security Scotland, we'll be sending out a specific SMS text message and or email to this cohort to tell them that they will need to reapply for their child as their child has aged out. And the rationale and considerations around this approach is because our user research testing showed us that we need to keep our messaging simple and clear. The risk of unclear messaging is that some people who are eligible for Scottish Child Payment may not apply for it. And of course, none of us want that. We want people who are eligible to apply. And in particular, our testing showed that if we restarted payments automatically for some clients, many others would assume that this applied to them as well, and they would have failed to apply and would therefore miss out. So we decided that one straightforward approach should apply to everyone. And as I've mentioned, we will be sending out a specific SMS text message and or email to tell them that they need to reapply for their child as their child has aged out. So we'll be doing that for the particular cohort referenced. That reassures,
Mr. Thank you, Mr. I'm just slightly confused that if we know who these individuals are, because you're sending them a text message, why couldn't we just automatically be rolled over? Because you know who they are because of the age of their birthday. You're sending their parents either a text or email. So why is it not just possible to say to that whole number of individuals, you continue with the benefit, nothing has changed?
I think it's important to recognise, as I said in my first answer, that we also need to consider the wider context of individuals who are still to apply for Scottish Child Payment and how we want to encourage them to apply. And the user research showed, and this has been based on that research, this decision-making process, that if we were to automatically engage this cohort in an application process that continued their payment, then that would lead to a wider consideration of others who may be eligible thinking that they would be automatically registered for Scottish Child Payment, and then that would mean that those who need to apply and wrongly thought that they may be automatically enrolled would then not apply. So we have to balance the situation between the needs of the people who are ageing out and also the wider cohort, the wider context of us wanting people to apply for the benefit. So the decision was made that while we would not undertake a process of restarting automatically Scottish Child Payment for children who have recently turned six, what we will do is proactively contact them and emphasise that they need to apply.
OK, I'm not quite sure I follow the logic of that, but so be it. The second question is, I mean, can the Minister just give us a wee bit more information of what discussions she's had with Social Security Scotland in regard to the number of staff that they have working at the moment and in regard to the processes and procedures in place so that the Scottish Child Payment will be up and running appropriately. I think there's an estimate of 200,000 more children are expected to qualify. Are you confident that there won't be the delays that we saw over the summer with other benefits? And are there an appropriate number of staff in place?
Yeah, a very important question, and I will bring Janet Richardson in shortly. But first off, I would just emphasise to Mr Balfour and the committee more widely that Social Security Scotland is well prepared for the extension of the Scottish Child Payment with the necessary staff, processes, training and support all now in place or scheduled imminently. As Mr Balfour has rightly emphasised, we can expect a large influx of applications once the benefit is extended on the 14th of November should Parliament pass these regulations. And to help manage this, at the same time, we are also introducing improvements to reduce manual processing of Scottish Child Payments applications, and we call this breakthrough processing. And this should impact positively on processing times. Straight-through processing is the increased automation of the processing of Scottish Child Payment applications, and this will mean that once the payment is extended to individuals responsible for children under 16 from the 14th of November, a high percentage of applications should be processed automatically without any manual intervention required. The system will carry out all of the same checks that a client advisor would perform, meaning clients will not be treated differently if their application is processed by the system, just for clarity. And only eligible cases with no outstanding actions or checks to be completed will be processed through to payment by the system. If a client is not eligible or fails any of the automated checks for any reason, then their case will be picked up by a client advisor to be processed manually. And any client who is awarded Scottish Child Payment where the decision was processed by the system will have the same redetermination and appeal rights, just for clarity, as a client who has a decision made by a client advisor. And we are being very clear that no application will ever be denied by the system. So we have those proper checks and balances. So a combination of organisational preparation through staffing and training and making sure that the agency is properly stood up for this anticipated increase in demand from the 14th of November, combined with straight-through processing, will be a good client journey for the people of Scotland. Janet, I don't know if you want to add anything beyond what I've said.
Thank you, Minister. Good morning, everyone. I hope you can all hear me. And apologies, I seem to have a not very stable Wi-Fi signal this morning, so I will try and be quick. And I think, Minister, you probably covered everything there, but just in response to Mr Balfour's query, yes, we obviously did have some processing challenges this year. But in addition to the information that you've just provided, Minister, we have recruited an extra 300 full-time equivalent people to help us through that Scottish Child Payment 2 phase. So they are now either in training or consolidation. So we are fully prepared for.
Just one final question on the section, Minister. In the announcement that you made in regard to this, you said or your this document from Scottish Government side, and I quote, given the large number of children forecasted to be newly eligible, that people applying for the first time might need to wait to get their award, unquote. What analysis have you done of how long people will have to wait? What is the expected processing time? And that message seems to be slightly different what we read in the document from what you're saying to committee today. So is there going to be no delay, or if there is a delay, how long will that delay be?
So again, I'll bring Janet in shortly from agency in terms of being on the ground, but I can tell you that there will be a processing period for people after application. But what I'm emphasising to committee today is that the straight through processing, together with the increased workforce that Janet Richardson has just emphasised to you, will mean that applications will be processed as quickly as possible, and some through the many through the automatic processes, and this will have a very positive impact on the client experience and waiting times. Obviously, the level of demand is still somewhat unknown, because we're not clear on how many people will apply in that first week from the 14th of November. But of course, we are projecting what we think will be the position, and we would want as many people to apply as possible. And of course, that is the overarching message from the government and the Parliament, and more widely. So we are prepared to process applications as quickly as possible. And I'll just pass over to Janet now to give further indication on the timescales for that.
Thank you, Minister. And yes, as you've outlined there, that is difficult to for us to predict, depending on the numbers. But what we have committed to is that we will keep clients updated every 2 weeks on where we are with their claim. And we recognise that, particularly with this opening so near to Christmas, people will be concerned about getting their money by then. So it will depend on what information we require to get for those clients, but we will do everything we can to get those payments out as quickly as possible, and we will keep people up to date with what is happening on their claim. And of course, when we do make that decision, it will be backdated to the date of their claim should there be any delay.
Thank you.
Much for that. I have a couple of questions round about changes to the linking period. Were there issues arising about how the linking period was working in practice that made the change necessary? And also, in what circumstances would there be a long delay between a client losing entitlement and Social Security Scotland making a decision to stop Scottish child payment?
Thank you, Convener. And, I'll bring Merlin Kemp in at the end here if there's anything further he wishes to add. But first of all, what's in these regulations is what we intended to happen all along with regard to the linking period. So the intent was that the agency could re-award Scottish Child Payment by making a determination without application within 12 weeks of someone losing their Scottish Child Payment award, due to no longer being entitled to a qualifying benefit or no longer being responsible for the child. The most likely scenario where this could happen is where someone loses their universal credit entitlement for a short period of time. We knew this could happen under universal credit, and so we did not want someone to have to submit a brand new application just because they lost universal credit for a month or two. This could also apply where someone temporarily does not have responsibility for a child. Unfortunately, what happens at the moment is that the 12-week linking period applies from when a decision is made on a change in circumstances. And in practice, there can sometimes be a long delay in a change of circumstances taking effect, and that change being notified to Social Security Scotland. This can mean that the agency automatically re-awards Scottish Child Payment after the client has not been eligible for a much longer time period than they originally intended 12-week period. And so the change in the regulations that we are seeking to make is consistent with the original policy intent to ensure that individuals are not automatically awarded Scottish Child Payment after long periods of ineligibility. And this change will allow for proper checks to be carried out to ensure eligibility and check for any other changes of circumstances. And just with regard to in what circumstances would there be a long delay between a client losing entitlement and Social Security Scotland making a decision to stop Scottish Child Payment? In those circumstances, if a client is late in reporting a change in their circumstances relating to their qualifying benefit or responsibility of the child to Social Security Scotland, that would result in their losing entitlement to Scottish Child Payment, or where there has been a delay between the client reporting that change to DWP or HMRC. An example of how this can happen in practice would be a client reporting that a child left their household 1 year ago to go and live in another household, for example, but they are now living back, living with the household as of today. And in those circumstances, it would be appropriate to end the claim with an effective date of 1 year ago, when the client was no longer responsible for the child, and for the client to apply for Scottish Child Payment again for the child at today's date. Appreciate there's a lot of detail there. I hope I've articulated that in a way that's helpful for the committee, and I'll just bring Merlin Kemp in if there's anything further he wishes to add. Thanks, Merlin.
Hi everyone, hopefully you can all hear me. I don't think I've got much to add to that. I think the Minister's illustrated the kind of circumstances where it could happen, the original policy intents, and how what happens in practice doesn't quite align, and has given you an example. I suppose just to reiterate the point why that's important, it's important that clients don't inadvertently accrue significant overpayments, because we don't want to be having to chase large overpayments. It's also important from a due diligence point of view that people aren't automatically re-enrolled on Scottish Child Payment after long periods of time. That's not just in the kind of due diligence in best interest of the Social Security Scotland in terms of stewarding public money, but it's also to make sure, for example, that other changes of circumstances haven't happened in the meantime, which could even include bank details and things like that. So you could end up in a situation where you're trying to pay money into a wrong bank account or something like that. So it's really about trying to make sure we were able to do that due diligence. And just the ways we have Social Security Scotland has access to systems, DWP information, for example, information on universal credit tends to go back only a few months. So once you go beyond those kinds of time periods as well, it becomes harder for Social Security Scotland to do those kind of more automated kind of checks, which make everything a bit more streamlined.
Thank you very much both for explaining that to us. I'm going to move on to questions first from Deputy Convener Natalie Dawn, and then to be followed by Emma Roddick. Natalie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, Minister and all officials. It's clear from a number of organisations and individuals that the increase to the Scottish Child Payment is really, really welcome, and we've seen and heard a whole host of evidence to support this. I think this Parliament is clearly ambitious in its aim to end poverty, and it's disheartening when this ambition is frustrated by UK government policy. It's clear the assistance offered by the SCP may be limited for some families due to the threshold rules around universal credit. So I'm just wondering, has there been any discussion with the UK Government or the DWP regarding the impact of the increased Scottish Child Payment and the potential that this could create a cliff edge, as I know some people might breach the universal credit threshold? And if so, what has been the result of this?
Thank you, Deputy Convener, and it's these are of course important matters, and why the constructive dialogue that we have with UK government at official level and I've had at ministerial level in my tenure as minister is important, because there's constant considerations between the reserve benefits and the future of those benefits and any changes that may be made to them as well, and of course what we're delivering in Scotland and with our devolved powers. The evidence that we have to date regarding the considerations around a cliff edge. There's a constant balance between that the UK government has to consider with regard to universal credit and incentives to work and supporting people, and the balance between the requirements in universal credit and the number of working hours that an individual undertakes. Where our consideration around cliff edges has been more of an area of consideration that we need to keep in mind as we go forward is with regard to the impact on second earners, for example. And the evidence that we have to date from our interim evaluation of Scottish Child Payment is that it may reduce barriers to education and the labour market for recipients. And of course, that's positive, including, for example, paying for travel to interviews, a new job or college. I do recognise the potential for the design of Scottish Child Payment to influence people's engagement with work, but there is no evidence at present of significant effects to date. However, we will always keep this issue under review as we make decisions about operating or as we review Scottish Child Payment more widely in the future. As set out in our Gender Pay Gap Action Plan, we are acutely aware of gender disparities in the labour market, and particularly the barriers women, and especially women with children, face in obtaining and progressing in work. And we need to keep those at the forefront of our mind with consideration to our family payments as well. And Scottish Government analysts will continue to monitor available data to assess where possible Scottish Child Payments impacts have a wider implication on the gendered impacts of the labour market. So these are both the interaction with universal credit and UK government policy, and more widely within considerations about access to the labour market. Of course, Scottish Child Payment is something that we need to collectively consider.
Thanks very much, Minister. Following on from that, I understand that the consultation, which is closing today, I believe, asked for views on various social security changes, including changing the legal basis of the Scottish Child Payment from a top-up benefit to a standalone benefit. And I think this would make it easier to address the problem of the cliff edge, as it would be legally possible to pay Scottish Child Payment to people who weren't getting reserve benefits. Can the Minister advise what policy options are being considered on this front?
So, as a member emphasised, our consultation on this is still live and closes today, and we encourage people to contribute it. Once that closes, officials will require some time to consider the feedback and policy options. There are challenges in this space with regard to how would we deliver in the future, both from considerations around what powers the Scottish Government has and technical capabilities for delivery. But we are keen to make improvements where we can, and we will aim to publish a response to the consultation in early 2023, which will set out some of our next steps. And as part of policy development, officials will consider whether there would be a benefit in modifying the legislative footing on which Scottish Child Payment is based, and that is certainly something that we...
Thank you. Just one more question. On a slightly more kind of general note and maybe less sort of technical, can the Minister outline what impact overall extending an increase in the Scottish Child Payment and the other measures that we're speaking about today will have on the Scottish Government's national mission to tackle child poverty?
Well, there's a lot that I could say about that, so I'll try and be as brief as I can. But of course, the decisions that we have taken have been made to deliver our second tackle in child poverty delivery plan. And we've also sought to go further and faster where we can be mindful of the cost families face in the current situation with the cost of living pressures and challenges and the levels of inflation. And of course, the story of the Scottish Child Payment is a good case in point in that regard, in that less than a year ago, the Scottish Child Payment was payable at a rate of £10 for eligible child under six, with a manifesto commitment to increase the rate to £20 by the end of this Parliament. And in fact, we delivered that increase in full in the first year of this Scottish Government during this parliamentary term. And now extending Scottish Child Payment to under 16s and increasing it further, we of course took the decision to increase it by an inflation busting 25% from £20 to £25, and to bring this increase forward by 4 months from April 2023 to November 2022. So these are significant interventions. At a rate of £25 per week per child, enhanced and extended Scottish Child Payment could lift 50,000 children out of poverty, reducing overall child poverty by an estimated 5 percentage points in the next financial year. And of course, that's something that we should all welcome and be focused and passionate about achieving. And of course, this sits in the context of the other work we are doing to tackle child poverty in Scotland, such as offering free school lunches during term time, rather to all pupils in primaries 1 to 5, saving families on average £400 per child per year. And this will be extended to primary 6 and 7 pupils by during the course of this Parliament. And we've obviously massively expanded the provision of fully funded high quality early learning and childcare, increasing school clothing grants to at least £120 for every eligible primary school pupil and £150 for every eligible secondary school pupil from the start of the 21-22 academic year. And indeed, recently launching the free bus travel for under 22 scheme and a number of other interventions. So the Scottish Child Payment rightly has attracted attention and focus because of its innovation as a policy and its clear focus and application to tackle poverty. But it's also part, along with our other devolved social security benefits, part of a wider set of policy interventions to help reduce poverty, to work towards meeting our targets, and also to help people in the current financial position with the cost of living pressures and the challenges that so many households are facing. I could say a lot more, but I'll probably leave it there, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. I'm going to move on to questions from Emma Roddick, to be followed by Pam Duncan-Glancy. Emma.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. As you mentioned, these regulations are increasing the Scottish Child Payment to £25 a week per child, and I understand this payment and other measures are unique in the UK. Can I ask how much money is provided when the 5 family benefits are taken together, and how that compares to support available elsewhere in the UK?
I think it's an important question because, as I said, the Scottish Child Payment is part of a number of payments from Social Security Scotland that are providing significant additional quantum of support for families. So taken together, the Scottish Child Payment, Best Start Grant Pregnancy and Baby Payment, Early Learning Payment, School Age Payment and Best Start Foods could be worth over £10,000 by the time a family's first child reaches 6, and £9,700 for subsequent children by the end of 2022. So a significant additional quantum of support. And this compares to less than £1,800 for eligible families first child in England and Wales, and under £1,300 for subsequent children. And this difference of more than £8,200 between what people receive in Scotland and elsewhere in the UK highlights this Scottish Government's major support in the early years for low-income families and our determination to provide assistance.
And I suppose following on from that, the UK government has made some decisions recently which have impacted on social security in Scotland. What has their actions and inactions had on our mission to tackle child poverty? Could we go further if the ambition being shown in Scotland were matched by the rest of the UK?
Yeah, unfortunately, I say that genuinely with disappointment, the UK government welfare reforms have reduced the income of the poorest households in Scotland, pushing households into poverty. And indeed, some of these policies, such as the benefit cap and the two-child limit, are targeted at households with children. And I've had casework of people who are being more challenged because of these policies, as I'm sure other members around the table have today. And this, of course, is in contrast to the Scottish Government's commitment to tackle child poverty, which is evidenced in the regulations we're considering today, which, of course, focus to a large extent on the game-changing Scottish Child Payment, which was created by the Scottish Government and implemented by the Scottish Government. That's the contrast. And, of course, there are other aspects, not just with the Social Security, where the UK government could do more with regard to employment law, for example, the minimum wage levels are reserved to Westminster, and other aspects of employment law. If changes were made with a focus on social justice at a UK level, a bigger difference could certainly be made.
Thank you. And just finally, has the Scottish Government done analysis into the impact of these welfare reforms? For example, are there figures that quantify the impact on people in Scotland if key UK welfare reforms were reversed?
Yes, there has been analysis done, and the Scottish Government estimates that reversing key UK government welfare reforms made since 2015 would increase the incomes of the poorest households in Scotland by over 10% in 23-24. So this would bring around 70,000 people out of poverty in Scotland, including 30,000 children, if the UK government took that action. Such action would include the reintroduction of the £20 per week uplift to universal credit, because the removal of this was the biggest overnight cut in benefits since the creation of the British welfare state. And reinstating this would move the most people out of poverty overall, although reversing historical reforms would have larger impacts on child poverty. And the total cost of reversing this, as in reversing the cut to universal credit and other reforms, including getting rid of the two-child limit, the removal of the family element, the removal of the benefit freeze and changes to universal credit work allowances and the taper rate, would be around £780 million per annum to the UK government. And reversing the reforms would increase disposable income for households with children with the lowest 10% of incomes by around 11%, and for households in poverty with children by 10%. So there's a huge amount of difference that could be made, and I could say more about the issues with universal credit. But I think the key message is that the UK government could and should be doing more in this space, and with our limited resources and powers in Scotland as a devolved government, we are doing all that we can to make the difference, to mitigate where we can. And of course, there's a lot of mitigation that's happened, but also to be innovative and proactive by introducing and increasingly extending the Scottish Child Payment, for example, as well as a number of other devolved benefits that are making an impact for families in Scotland. There's, of course, always more that could be done, and we constantly look at ourselves to ask what more we can do with our limited resources and powers. But certainly where we can make a difference, we're be proactive in that space, and I think these regulations before us today show that very clearly.
Thank you very much, Minister. I'm going to move to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. Pam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and to your officials too. And I'll start where on a point of agreement, which is that I too also do not believe the UK Government have done enough to support people during this cost of living crisis, and I completely agree with the Minister on that. The areas that I'm interested in are around the promotion of EMA as a follow-on to Scottish Child Payment. And I know that this has been touched on already, but I wonder, Minister, if you could set out what you're doing to make that process as automated as it could be, or, and in fact, indeed, automated entirely.
Thank you. And like I said, first recognise that I think it's a good thing for the benefit of all of Scotland that the EMA is in place in Scotland. Whereas that is not the case in other parts of the UK. Whilst we in the Scottish Government cannot guarantee that all who age out of the Scottish Child Payment will be eligible for the Educational Maintenance Allowance, the EMA, we have considered the likelihood that those turning 16 may transition onto EMA, rather, and we are working to ensure that relevant signposting is in place for those people. So we are developing an insight-driven communication and engagement plan, which will be a live document, continuously reviewed and updated ahead of. So we're developing it ahead of the rollout, and it will be reviewed and updated. We have included an objective in our communication strategy to raise awareness of the EMA as a form of support for those ageing out of Scottish Child Payment at age 16. And we are currently working on the best approach to achieve this objective. The EMA is currently promoted in schools as well as online and via local authority websites. And we are working to ensure that any promotion of Scottish Child Payment in schools is conscious of the links to EMA and complements any existing engagement already carried out. So it's a point well made by the member and the committee. I hope my answer reassures that there is both consideration and action underway in this space, and we certainly will be focused as a government, as with our partners that I've mentioned, on making sure that we do help people to access the support of the EMA once they age out of Scottish Child Payment.
Thank you. I thank the Minister for the answer. I feel, in part, that still sounds quite a bit like there's a reliance on the individual again to apply. Is there a reason why there couldn't be an automatic follow-on that I'm not aware of?
Well, there are two different systems. I'll bring Janet Richardson in a moment, but they are different systems. Of course, there are longer term ambitions, not just within the Scottish Government, but with colleagues in local authorities and other public service providers, to, from a digital perspective, make the journey and the access of support as easy as possible for people in Scotland, and that's an ongoing piece of work. But in terms of any automation in this space, it's not, because the EMA isn't delivered by Social Security Scotland, it's not something that can be implemented within the Social Security system. But as I've emphasised, there's already action underway and partnership underway to help people be aware of the EMA and how to apply, and to encourage them to do that as the age of Scottish Child Payment. Jan, I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
Thank you, Minister. I don't think I can add anything to the automation part, but just really to emphasise that our local delivery and national engagement teams within Social Security Scotland will be promoting this or making sure people are aware of this as much as any of our other benefits as well. And they are out with stakeholders and partners, making sure as much information is available as can be.
Can I have one final follow-up? Thank you both for that. Are there plans to combine the delivery?
Could the member elaborate on that slightly?
Are there plans to combine? So you say that the payments are made by different organisations. Is that what you said?
There are no plans at present to bring the EMA within the remit of Scotland. And it is not a social security benefit. But certainly, as there is on a number of different areas, significant engagement between local authorities and Social Security Scotland and different aspects of the public sector delivery landscape. And one of the important things in recent years is raising awareness of what Social Security Scotland does with partners and making sure that we're working as collaboratively as possible. And I think this example of the EMA is a good one of where, in order to get support to people that we want people to have, there is a degree of engagement required between different aspects of the public sector. And I hope my answer reassured you that there's proactive engagement happening already to make sure that people are aware of the EMA and how to apply and to encourage them to do so. And we will continue to look at this issue, and I thank the member.
Thank you. If I combine it with one of the questions I have in the other theme to be quicker later, can I ask a follow-up? Because actually it's a good example of
Absolutely.
What I was going to ask about. Thank you, convener. On that then, I wonder, I know later that we were going to come to issues of processing, and you say in the policy note that there's going to be a development of existing signposting and referral pathways. Could the Minister set out what those are? Because having done various bits of engagement, I'm not aware that there are referral pathways between Social Security Scotland and other public sector organisations, including the NHS and possible local authorities as well, in the same way that DWP have those referral mechanisms.
So with regard to... Does the member mean in a safeguarding capacity or...?
My understanding in conversations with various people working locally, there isn't that referral system that you can use from the DWP, for example, to another agency where it make a direct referral, but within Social Security Scotland that direct referral option is not available. And I think it sounds somewhat like it's a more manual sort of workaround where someone would say you should speak to, and then Social Security Scotland might go the other direction and say to their clients, you should speak to this agency or the other agency. But there's no automation of that referral process or directly recognised referral process, if that's clearer.
I'm not sure how directly relevant this is to the regulations, convener, but I will bring Janet Richardson in a moment and elaborate as much as I can at this juncture to the member, and happy to follow up on this point if that would be helpful. I would maintain that the level of collaboration between Social Security Scotland and partner agencies, whether that's the NHS, local authorities, or more widely, is strong. There are a number of aspects to consider with regard to the sharing of information and data protection, which I'm sure members will appreciate. We need to be extremely careful about and mindful of. But also, there are issues of safeguarding that the agency is, of course, engaged in and considerate of, and that's an important aspect of how we support clients in the application process and more widely where appropriate. Janet, I don't know if you want to add anything to that, and I'm certainly happy to give an undertaking to follow up to the the committee and through the committee, convener yourself, the member, on these points, if that would be a benefit.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Minister. And yes, the member is quite correct in that that policy is not fully in place yet, but we are developing that signposting and referrals policy, which will allow us to do that procedure that, which you've referred to as DWP do, and we expect to have that in place hopefully next year. So at the moment, very much our process is where we will signpost, or we will talk to clients about benefits or the things they may be entitled to, and we will refer them to those organisations and work with those organisations ourselves. But we won't do those direct referrals just now, which we have talked about. But that is to come, hopefully in 2023. But as Minister, you've said, we can get more information about that outside of this meeting. That would be helpful.
Thank you both. That's helpful.
Yeah, thanks very much. And I think any further information that can come forward to the committee on that would be appreciated, Minister. I'll move to questions from Jeremy Balfour, then to be followed by my colleague Fozil Chowdhury, who joins us remotely. Jeremy?
Thank you. Just if I can, two questions, Minister. As the Deputy Convener said, there is a consultation which comes to an end today. But I'm just wondering, when you were looking at the Scottish Child Payment, why did you not go for a standalone benefit or a new benefit under the Power of the Act? What was the reason not to do that at the very start?
Of course, the creation of new benefit from memory would require further engagement with the DWP and considerations around working with UK Government. I'm sure the member will appreciate that I was not the minister at the time of the creation of the Scottish Child Payment. I'll bring Merlin Kemp in a moment if there's anything further he would like to add. I think it's important to recognise that we were also seeking to provide support as quickly as possible in the period of the pandemic, and also to provide additional support to help families with additional needs, and also to tackle poverty. So there was a consideration around expedience, and also making sure that the most appropriate power was used to deliver a strategic solution to help people. But Merlin, I don't know if you want to add anything on that. Thanks.
Yeah, before my time too, but I have read up on it and discussed it with previous colleagues, and there were kind of position papers that are publicly available on the Scottish Government website as well. And really, it was a combination of, I think the pressing concern was getting a new payment delivered quickly. And so the top-up powers were part of the reason the top-up powers were used was to get payments delivered quickly. The other one of the kind of key benefits of the top-up power is we have a very efficient, especially compared to lots of other social security benefits, application process. because essentially we can do a lot of the checks on behalf of clients when they apply to check, for example, their whether they've got universal credit and the child element of universal credit. So it makes for a streamlined application process that can be, there's a real benefit to clients as well. But there are obviously, as has been discussed, limitations to the use of top-up powers, and that's why we've got the consultation to kind of consider further developments in the future.
Thank you. My final question, Minister, is one of the regulations that you haven't mentioned is you're now taking away the requirement for SGP to be paid within 4 weeks of getting the application. And the draft policy note again said in April, and I quote, often this deadline cannot be met due to high volume claims Social Security Scotland manage. So obviously that was back in April. We're now nearly in November. Has that changed? Are you confident people will get the payment within 4 weeks of application? And if not, with due respect to the Social Security Agency, it's all very well getting a letter saying every 2 weeks, but what people want is money in my bank account. So are you, why is that regulation gone that you can't guarantee payment within 4 weeks?
So as emphasised in my previous answer with regard in processing times, and I'll bring official colleagues in a moment if there's anything further they want to add, but there is a strong commitment from the Scottish Government and from Social Security Scotland as a delivery agency to pay people as quickly as possible. There was a consideration around whether the four-week period was appropriate, and that is why we've got to make this change in these regulations, but there is a strong focus at a delivery level on why we want to get money to people as quickly as possible. And I'll bring in Janet if there's want to add anything on that. And Karen, I don't know if you want to add anything from an SGLD perspective. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Minister. If I go first, I'm not sure I can add much to what you've already said there, Minister, but just to remind also that a large percentage of those clients, they will go through that straight-through processing automation process, which will make the payments quicker. So there will be some clients that we will have to do manual intervention, but hopefully that will be smaller. So therefore, the resources will be able to deal with that comes through in a timely fashion. But we will keep clients updated, and we will do everything we can to make sure people receive that money as quickly as possible. We do understand why they need that money. But Karen, I don't know if you've got anything to add.
Morning all. No, actually, I don't think there's anything I could add to the Minister and Janet's.
Thanks both.
Thank you very much. We'll move on to, I think, our final question, which comes from Faisal Chowdhury, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I think most of my questions are answered, but I just have got a small question for the minister. Has the Scottish Government considered the impact of the cliff edge on social mobility?
Thanks, Mr. Chowdhury, for that question. I mean, I did talk about this earlier in my answer around the cliff edge to Natalie Dawn, but there are ongoing considerations on the impact of the Scottish Child Payment and clients' engagement with work, but there is no evidence of significant effects to date.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Well, is that you finished, Faisal?
Yeah, that's me. That's, thank you.
Thank you very much. We'll now move on to agenda item number 2, which is the formal consideration of motion S6M05966, calling for the committee to recommend approval of the Social Security Miscellaneous Amendment and Transitional Provisions Scotland Regulations 2022. And I just remind everybody that only the Minister and members may speak in this debate. And I invite the Minister to speak to and move the motion.
Thank you, Convener. I urge colleagues, based on our discussion today and what I said in my opening statement, and more generally to support these regulations, particularly the uplift and extension of Scottish Child Payment will make a significant difference for a lot of our constituents in this challenging time, and there are various times in the course of a parliament where MSPs can make a difference for people, and I would suggest that this is one of those moments, and strongly urge colleagues to support these regulations and both the increase and the extension of Scottish Child Payment and the positive impact that will have for many households at this challenging time. Thanks.
And can I just get you to formally move it?
And formally moved. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. And just now to look to members if they have any contributions they want to make. And Jeremy, yep.
Thank you, convener. Clearly, we will be voting for this regulations. However, I think it's worth putting on record just 3 points, 1 procedural and 2 in regard to these particular regulations. I mean, I do think, and the Minister will know, because when he sat in this committee, I used to make the same point, I do think it is unfortunate the way that the procedure is set up for this, that you're asked to vote on something immediately after taking evidence. And I do think we have to look at how that actually is properly scrutiny. If there had been things there that the Minister had wanted to go back and reflect on, or we as a committee had wanted to go back and reflect on, we'd be asked to make that decision immediately. And I do think there should still be a week in between the regulations being discussed with government ministers, and then a week later the regulation being voted. I appreciate that it's not the Minister's role, he may not want to comment on that, but I think it is worth pointing out that there is a lack of scrutiny there. I suppose in regard to these regulations themselves, I heard what the Minister said, but I still cannot quite understand why those who are going to fall into this category of the October birthday could simply not be transferred automatically. I don't see this logic of if suddenly somebody was going to be transferred, somebody else wouldn't apply. I generally don't see that. And I do worry that there will be people that will be drop off the system and will miss out on money in regard to this. So I do think that is a slight concern, and we will obviously have to wait and see what happens in practice. The second issue, as I've raised a number of my questions, is in regard to when will these payments actually be made. And it does seem to me slightly strange that we're getting rid of this four-week guaranteed payment, which does treat people with respect and dignity. And I worry that we're moving away from that, and the agency is moving away from that. We did see over the summer, particularly when BEST Grant, really quite a large delay in regard to people getting their applications processed and then the money, where appropriately, put into their bank account. We've got, obviously, ADP being rolled out at the same time as well. We've seen delays, and I haven't really been reassured by the Minister or by Social Security Scotland Agency that we're not going to see these delays again. And, you know, we are approaching Christmas. It's going to be a difficult time for many individuals, and I am concerned that the money won't appear in my account at the proper time. I hope I'm wrong, and we will no doubt come back to this and look at this once it actually happens. So, clearly, we welcome the policy development under this, but in regard to the practicality of delivering it, I do think the government could have been slightly more ambitious and slightly more open and willing to help those who already have that benefit to continue with it. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Jeremy, do I have any other contributions to the panel?
Thank you, Convener. Whilst we in the Scottish Labour Party obviously welcome the Scottish Child Payment and the additional money that is allocated to that on the additional £5 top-up a week, we also share some concerns about the delays to rolling this out in full, not just as a result of some of the acute issues that we may see over the next few months with the uptick in application, but also just because of the number of years it's taken for over sixes to access this payment. I understand that the Minister...
Would I'm glad to take an intervention.
I will. I forgot that was an option at this point. Yes, I will indeed.
thank you, Pamela McGlancy, and thank you, Convener. I know this is challenging remotely, but I just want to clarify on that point that with regard to the implementation of the extension of the Scottish Child Payment to under 16s, the Scottish Government would like to have delivered that from day one of Scottish Child Payment, but it was actually our engagement with DWP and the need to get the required data from DWP and the pressures on their side and working with them in a way that we need to collaboratively that has delayed the process. So I just think it's both inaccurate and unfair for Scottish Labour to state that there hasn't been a determination from the Scottish Government to pay Scottish Child Payment to under 16s as soon as possible. There absolutely has been from the Scottish Government, and that's why we implemented for under 60s as soon as possible. Otherwise, the whole Scottish Child Payment would have taken longer. So the delivery of the policy to under 60s first and then to under-16s as soon as we could, with the requirement to have data from the DWP. It has been a position that was agreed in order to deliver the Scottish Child Payment as quickly as the Scottish Government could. And of course, the Scottish Government created the Scottish Child Payment with powers that were acquired by the Scottish Government, making the case for more powers from the Scottish Parliament. So I think it's important to bear these things in mind. Thanks.
I thank the Minister for that possible statement as opposed to an intervention at the length. Despite my forgetting my surroundings in terms of being able to take an intervention, I could have predicted that that particular intervention was coming. And what I was about to say was that I understand that there have been some difficulties with rollout. I think the Minister said something quite interesting in his intervention there, where he pointed out that it is our engagement with the DWP to get the data that had been the issue. And that is therein lies the concern that I have. And I believe that both of our governments should be engaging much, much better on matters of household finances, particularly in a time of cost of living pressures. And I honestly think that we need to get to a position where both governments can work more closely on this. I was also about to say that I am not too much interested in some of the negotiations between them. I am, however, interested in the fact that thousands of children weren't able to access that payment from the date at which the Scottish Government and others considered that it would be necessary for them to have. And had they got it at an earlier date, and whether that be at the door of the DWP or the Scottish Government, had those families got it at that date, the last 2 years would have been significantly better for them. So I just wanted to yet again put on the record my frustration about the rollout to over sixes. But I will finish where I started earlier, which is to say that, of course, we welcome any extra funding through the Scottish Child Payment that those families can get at this time, and we will be voting for the regulations today.
Thanks very much, Pam. Just from myself, one small comment, but I think it's something that we have to recognise as significant, and that's just the expansion with regards to kinship care. I think that's something that this committee has heard directly from those who deliver such care, who are fantastic people right across Scotland, and I think that will be these regulations seek to make their lives and the children that they look after that much better. So if we've got no other contributions from members, I'll now invite the Minister to sum up and respond to anything that he's heard. Thank you.
In the interest of time, Convener, I won't comment further other than to say that I do welcome the support of colleagues, despite their caveats, some of which I think are unfair. But in the interests of expediency, I thank them for their support, and I'm glad that the Parliament will be supporting these regulations. The committee will be supporting these regulations today, and look forward to them being implemented and the difference that will make for many, many people. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. And I'll just do the formal part of that now. So the question is that motion SXM 05966 in the name of Ben McPherson, MSP, be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. The committee will report on the outcome of this instrument in due course, and I invite the committee to delegate authority to me as convener to approve a draft of the report for publication. Are we agreed with that?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. And thank you, Minister, and your officials, and you, even despite COVID, to be here today to ensure that we can get these regulations in front of the Parliament as soon as possible. So thank you very much.
And
I now close the public part of this meeting, and the committee is going to move into private session to consider its pre-budget 2023-2024 draft report. Thank you very much, everybody.